to, you know, like Zippy, his team over there, to find kind of the lost little puppy or the lost little lamb that Rengar found.
That makes sense. That could definitely be something there. Alternatively, Rengar jumps in and says, like, well, you're gonna go by yourself, I'm gonna send five people at you, and we're gonna pop the ultimate, and we're all gonna charge towards your team. So there's lots of different ways they can use it. I hope we see one of those. In reality, it's probably gonna just be used to hunt down one person. But I have hope. I have faith in GT that they can execute this composition. But we have them facing down LGD in our first matchup of the day. It will be our first best of three as we gear towards our match of the week later today. So let's get into this one for us, Kieran.
You have hope. I have questions. You know, what do Xiaoyu and West actually look like consistently? Mm-hmm. West and Savoki certainly will be tested against the likes of PYL and Imp, especially because they got kind of the, I'm going to call them soft counters with the Lulu into the Malzahar. The fact that they got their hands on Varus, even with Caitlyn, it's going to be impossible to try to get wave priority against Varus just because he has line wave clear as well as AoE push potential on Q and his hail of arrows. So I just feel like they're going to be sitting under their tower for a very long time.
Yeah, I mean, that's probably how it will play out in the bottom. Oh my god, that is frightening.
You can tell the Chinese observer, like, yes, Kled again.
Yeah.
Get me in there.
I'm pretty sure the English version of Skull does not sound that horrifying. Because that was some Jurassic Park Velociraptor noises I just heard right then.
In the kitchen, hunting.
Yeah, that was
did he
that
get
was interesting.
Every raptor? Okay.
Every small raptor, yeah. We've seen this once before in the LPL, where we'll give them the slight level advantage to the Caitlyn if they get the just in time. Well, Savoka's going to get all the experience from that one.
My issue is that Caitlyn level 2 is not nearly as punishing as other AD carries level 2. And so while I respect it and that you're able to do it so easily with Malzahar because you can take with the Voidlings, it's pretty much like, now I have Caliburnet. If I hit Caliburnet, I can trade a really nice headshot on you. And if I time it with a second headshot, you know, maybe my all-in potential is there. But you give up a lot of your positioning on the initial wave and you still have the same problems. I'm level 2, but I'm still underneath my tower.
Sure, and I think for the same reasons you mentioned before, Frustrian, where you're West against Imp and PYL, why not just go for these Raptors and say, I'm probably going to lose the level 1 anyway, so let me just get some more experience and make it easier for me to just kind of pad my way through the early game in the first couple levels.
This is kind of interesting. So they've spotted Kha'Zix out on a ward, and PYL is now moving underneath Xiaoyu, but he doesn't know.
PYL just came up here. He's going to hit him with a Glitter Lance as Xiaoyu backs away. He takes a fair beating. He's already gone all the way through his refillable potion.
And we've seen several LPL teams kind of make this play. It's set up by the initial level 1. So if you sacrifice your level 1 wave bottom by taking Raptors, like we saw West and Savoki do, you give better positioning to the enemy AD carrying support, and the supports will roam on that level 2. You never expect it. We saw WE do it when they faced EDG way back when, and now we saw LGD attempt it on Game Talents. Fortunately for Game Talents, it didn't result in their jungler dying. But can you imagine how disastrous it would have been if Kha'Zix had fallen?
It feels so bad dying early on when you have those double buffs, which are so crucial for the early game of the junglers. But no kill just yet, and it did mean that the wave priority did briefly go back over to West, and it's all but equalized the farm differential down there. Junglers are both heading back to base as well.
It also means that you have to be that much more sharp about where Varus' level 6 is, simply because Lulu disappeared for a little bit, so he did get that solo EXP, and like Ashe, he's one of those champions, if he surprises you at level 6, wrap you with that ultimate, and track down a pretty easy kill.
Especially on the likes of Savoki, who is a low mobility mage, and if they burn his flash beforehand as well, gonna be a kill with Intruder heading down, and a Shen on top of him, mid lane. Republic just trading off against Godfrey. He's low on mana, so he's not looking for a kill or anything. Probably just wants to shove in this wave and then look for a back timing.
It's one of the best things about Corki into Ryze is that Corki's going to have early push priority on pretty much majority of mid lane champions in meta. And the thing about Ryze is he has great push priority because they moved a lot of his wave clear from his ultimate onto his other abilities when they made the changes to him, and he can't get that early tier back. Like, Ryze wants to walk into the lane, try to shove it forward as fast as possible, bounce off tower, and while it's bouncing back to him, get that tier. Normally it would happen about now, but against Corki, you can see that he's kind of stuck here. He's got no mana, he can't leave because he wants to get these creeps, and he's just being punished for a more delayed back timer in the specific matchup.
Is he probably going to get, like, two of these minions?
That's rough.
One of these minions? Yeah.
That
like,
feels bad.
He has to stay, but if he stays, he doesn't get the minions anyway. So it's just a straight up lose-lose situation. He really wants to go back. He just is like Xiaoyu just to turn up in mid lane, but then you lose the advantage from jungle, and it's just, yeah, it just feels straight up bad.
Intruder could have placed his control ward after he killed the Zord. Or maybe he was losing vision on it, and
there
he could only
go.
Get the two hits.
Now Xiaoyu shows his face in mid lane.
Someone needs to help
this
Ryze.
Just go back to base. He can't do it. Top lane, violent tendencies onto Funny. He's just kind of getting these even trades. But you can see he's lost scars, so he'll get a lot of that health back as soon as he procs it with the next combo from his little shotgun thing, hand cannon.
Shotgun's pretty accurate. Good news.
There we go.
Scar returns, but better news for Ryze. He did manage to get back, probably backed on a cannon wave, so he would lose less of the farm that Corki's just been punishing. You can see the CS discrepancy opening up. It's only going to get worse because Ryze is, you know, like, hoofing it back to lane. But he's also got his boots, so.
One of those things we never really show too much because in the grand scheme of things, oh, holding that fort because Xiaoyu's coming in here up against an intruder. Realm will come in as well. Republic does have his flash. He'll chase after. Land the rune prison as well. Isolated damage. And Xiaoyu will come up with first blood.
Excellent communication from Xiaoyu and Republic right there. Republic getting the Realm Warp so he could follow up on that. And that's three summoners burned, Flash, Ghost, and Flash on jungler. But first blood?
First blood over to GT and Xiaoyu of all people. So in terms of snowballing picks, that's exactly where you want it.
And that's twice now in different series that Intruder has really been punished early level for just, you know, trying to make invades at poor times. God V wasn't in lane, he didn't have any follow-up, didn't respect the enemy vision, and this could very quickly snowball back on him.
Gimgoon chasing into the top lane, gets Bear Trap and Rope down as well onto Funny. Finally, the Refuge has been parked by Funny, but that was a little close for comfort. Both of them had Flash, so in reality, he was probably safe. But Gimgoon, now that he's got that level 6, does have great chasing power, so he's still under attack. Doesn't know where Rengar is, though, because he was recently killed and came back onto the map, so it was a risky play. But could have gone for it.
But will Intruder reveal his positioning to grab all of this gold that's going to be crashing into the tower? His top laner doesn't have teleport, so unfortunately some of the creep will go down. But again, this is Intruder's decision making. He takes Krugs and he immediately walks across map. He doesn't go top to show himself.
I think in reality, not too many creeps are going to be missed, but the point I wanted to make earlier is we never really show how many creeps are going to be missed. Because as a laner, when in-game, in the game of League of Legends, that's really what you feel bad about. You know, you go back to the and it's like, I've missed 200 god, I've missed 230 god, I've missed 250 god, as you see the creeps dying. But in competitive, it's more about the big map movements, so we kind of missed that one just a little bit. Xiaoyu just giving this blue buff over to Republic, and that was a pretty clean one. We've seen many a blue buff not quite hit the mark in donations, but Intruder's actually down here with PYL. Because they had the plus advantage in the bottom main, and Savoki had to go back, so Intruder's going to walk in and take red.
And it's learning from your past mistakes, you know. Intruder tried to invade on that initial ward, gave up first blood. This time around, he backs, times it with PYL, and invades with his support. They use the fact that Republic on the blue buff now heading top was across map with his jungler to steal away red buff.
Let's go down. They know there's a ward in that bush, but here comes the gank into bottom lane. Intruder's going to launch himself onto Wes. He has Jhin on top of him. Such an easy dive, and Savoki's got nowhere to go. PYL chimes in with the final kill there. And LGD, two kills and probably bot lane tower.
Yeah, and they've got the wave coming in, so it will be first brick. Republic and Xiaoyu are just trying to find table scraps at this point. You know, they attempted to make a push, possibly mid, but Godby stalled that. Now it's just kind of this stalemate of, well, if I can't take your tower, I will deny you creeps.
Small victories, we take those. Gimgoon is doing a fair amount of damage to the top tower. He's got violent tendencies coming up soon as well, so he will get probably most of that tower, if not the tower. He's got Kha'Zix coming up, so yeah, that tower is pretty dead.
One for one trade, ultimately still more gold in LGD's pocket, and they'll also get the initial rotation about where they move their bottom lane. You would think that it would either be mid or the top lane, but LGD get a little bit funky sometimes.
Yeah. Could be one or the other. Gimgoon is in a pretty good spot, honestly. He'll go back to base. He went for Tiamat first. He's not under threat of dying to Shen. And he's opened up a nice CS advantage for himself as well, as Shen had to look for that roam. So Gimgoon back to base. Is it going to be right towards the Titanic Hydra? Well, he's picked up the Warhammer as well, along with his Tiamat. So looks like he was considering going back top lane. It looks like a call went elsewhere. I think they're looking towards Dragon right now.
Well, they have this window where Funny's doing his best to hold the way forward. Of course, it's a little bit difficult because he does have Bomby Cinder, so he can't control it as well as he would like. But right now, Gimgoon has nowhere to be on the map other than kind of grouping with his team, applying pressure to different lanes. He doesn't want to be that overextended, and he's waiting for that big collection of CS just to push back safely for him.
So he can just go into the top lane and collect it. And that's exactly what he's doing right now, heading back up river. 10 minutes in, and no one has taken the dragon just yet. LGD do have the wards over the area. And Savoki and PYL in the support wards. Kind of place down a bit of damage, a bit of poke, and a couple of wards as well. But the fact that LGD have so much vision over this area will mean that they will take this dragon away. Xiaoyu is in the area if he wants to try a steal attempt. With no flash, it would be a one-way trip.
And it's also the TP discrepancy. So LGD did a good job. They didn't see where Gimgoon was. They made sure that they just played kind of defensively until Gimgoon was forced to show his face top. They have the teleport timing. They take Dragon when they know that they have a numbers advantage over that pit. Meanwhile, GT are like, it's Ocean. We don't care. Next one's Infernal. Buckle up, boys.
Yeah, that's when we're going to be going in here with Gimgoon's ultimate. Throw Savoki in there with Republic and really get them into the fight. Godfrey was looking for a gank into the top lane, but Funny was like, not entirely sure we'll be able to kill him even if you come up here. Just go mid lane and farm. An Impel push down the bottom lane here as well up against West. So this is a heavy push coming out from LGD. They need to be a little careful as there are many people coming down to the bot lane. Xiaoyu's one of them, but he is getting blasted currently. Glidlance comes across, so there's Missile Barrage. We've got Gimgoon on the outsides and the outskirts of this fight, but with five men strong, LGD, Gimgoon does not really want to be throwing himself in there.
And ultimately, it's LGD that come out ahead after all is said and done because they use the Stand United versus the Teleport cooldown. So they maintain a lot more pressure because their cooldowns will be up faster on the map.
They do have this 1,000 gold advantage as well with that dragon. So LGD, just with a healthy advantage. It's not game-changing, but it is nice to have. Gimgoon is waiting here, taking away this red buff. I believe he has been spotted out there. There was a couple things going down, or I actually think that was Xiaoyu saying, back away, I want it. Yep, there you go. That makes more sense. Gimgoon heading up there, sees PY out, so they have the vision over that area, as well as Intruder coming down. So if they stick around, there'll be Knife Cat jumping on their faces, but they're going to back off to river.
But we now have the earlier rotation, or LGD kind of setting pace of the game, and that they swap their duo lane back towards the top side. Again, you look at Funny, he's trying his best just to hold the wave, constantly backing off the creep so the Bomby Cinder doesn't auto-push it. And they've now also stalled Gimgoon's back. So LGD, for kind of the last 15 to 20 seconds, have been much more proactive because they've been on the map in the right areas, and it's led to this giant wave accumulating topside.
They'll push it in, but Savoki was on his way top lane, and Xiaoyu's there, plus there was a ward on it from LGD, so they'll get a little bit of chip damage onto the top tower, but it should all be collected by West here. He may look for the gank though with Intruder and Govi as they're just around the corner, but Xiaoyu should have seen this out. Yeah, ping has come down, and LGD get the message. They get the memo. They'll back away off to mid lane once more. So surprisingly in this game for us, Kieran, I feel like Vision is been pretty strong from both teams, which has denied a lot of the plays that we see getting set up.
Yeah, despite kind of the early level one, not level one, but level three blunders from Intruder, LGD have certainly picked it back up. They just need to make sure that as long as, hold on.
Well, let's see how much damage does that do. It does quite a lot, actually. Realm Walk comes in. He'll jump over the wall, but now he's kind of in the middle of nowhere while Intruder will jump in his face. Xiaoyu's there as well, takes him out of the Evolved W. PYL caught out by Savoki. And there's the ultimate ace in the hole. Oh, it's not enough damage. The flash and the Q coming out there from Savoki. But PYL is stumped. He's still alive somehow. Single digits of HP. Bottom lane, Funny in the 1v1 against Gimgoon. But he gets gold back and keeps him alive. Last minute, the hero that he needed.
What the hell just happened? The entire map just exploded simultaneously. Okay. Is it over? No.
Oh, it's not, because Imp's in the bush. Of course he is. West will flash away. There's a counter flash from Imp, but he's simply not in range, and he's getting eaten by Savoki's minions. He'll back away.
I would love to see the replay of that, to see if Imp let go of the arrow before or after he flashed. It was just slightly too short. But this is where it starts. We were just commending LGD about their vision, and then Republic catches out Godby, and it forces Intruder to overextend into Kha'Zix and Ryze to try to save his mid laner. Ultimately, both go down, and because everyone has information about where the junglers are, everyone's like, let's all 1v1 or 2v2.
We have this chance. So many plays didn't quite work out. They're just thirsty for a fight, honestly, and that's what we saw across maps. So All in all, there was a slight advantage to GT, and that's evened up the 1,000 gold advantage we just spoke about, because that mid lane tower went down. So GT back on a level playing field, but they did take that middle tower, which is quite important.
And it'll help them start to place their deep vision and pivot around it. They've been doing such a good job in kind of these little catches on LG, just kind of overextending on the vision again, catching Intruder when he tries to invade Raptors, catching Godvian when he's trying to make a back on that ramp. Just every mid laner, just back up. Just go to your tower. It's not worth it.
It costs you an extra 2-3 seconds at the cost of your life. I think it's probably worth it, in all honesty. But yeah. Just being a little greedy there, and that means that that overextension will result in a mid lane tower, 2 kills, and GT getting more control over the map. And especially with Infernal Dragon coming up in 1 minute, not really what LGD wanted.
Which now puts even more pressure that LGD need to be so much more consistent on laying their vision on the Infernal. They still have the Varus, he's still got his Dirk as well as his Ghost Blade, so as long as they have the vision set up, we always use this analogy, fish in a barrel. Varus is going to hurt, which means that it's all about denial and acquiring a vision.
Well, we can get an advantage with the classic Corki combo with Funny on top of him. He'll cancel out Savoki's ultimate, but Godvian's still getting a lot of damage. West is under the tower, but Xiaoyi's getting chased down, and the last rocket will finish him off. West jumped on by Knifecat. I mean, what are you going to do when there's a Rengar on your face right there? 3 kills over to LGD. A nice setup in the top lane. They'll take this one away.
And this is what we expect from LGD. GT have been doing a good job kind of keeping the lanes locked down 1v1, 2v2, and finding small advantages there, or at least neutralizing it. But when LGD get together, when they make the macro movements, this is when you start to see the difference between these two teams strategy-wise.
This is a big power play from LGD. They took one tower. They'll take a second. Funny comes into the bottom lane, and Gimgun and Republic will try and tag team him down, but Funny is not dying quickly. Gimgun, he loses Skull, he'll still keep following after Republic, now has the tower aggro. Gimgun comes in with the hand cannon, but Funny's still alive. Last auto attack, and the overload out from Republic finally finishes him off before they turn their attention to the tower.
And that dive was only possible simply because when Kled jumps off of Skarl, it resets tower aggro, and it traded over into Ryze, allowing them to actually get a nice dive. But looking back at this replay, this is them just playing numbers advantage, knowing that Republic was on the bottom side of the map. So GT being out of position, and then LGD's composition having the tools to punish that with the Corki and Shen ultimate. Mm-hmm.
Really cool as well, with the interaction between Shen and whoever that Savoki is hitting with his ultimate can just instant taunt him and get him out of that situation. Impith pushing down the mid lane as well, and West really needs to take this one away. That would be a big loss for LGD, but there's teleports coming in left and right. Imp caught out in the mid lane, and PYL, now he wants to get out of it. He's giving him a Wild Growth, that's all you're getting, mate. Gimgun coming across, Bear Trap on the rope did not quite land onto Lulu as she backs away. A flash will come out, Violent Tendencies as well from the Kled. So much damage! And Xiaoyu comes across with his own Void Spikes for the kill. Intruder locked up and stuck in Rune Prison, while Godfrey's also looking to back away here. Overload just misses the mark barely. Intruder turns around, but Xiaoyu's here to take out his opposition. Godfrey locked down, there's no taunt to save him this time. And GT will continue the dive under tower. That's an ace for GT!
And Shu is on the other foot this time around. GT get the jump on LGD, they make the correct collapse. But here's the key difference between the teams. GT, they don't get anything off of that. When LGD made the collapse, when they got their correct members towards the top side, they instantly got a tower. GT have to respond to the waves. This is what we're talking about when we say side wave management before you look to a fight. Come on, Observer, I don't want to replay right now.
Well, we get to see it once more. A lot of this was just mechanical and LGD getting called out. There was not a lot to it other than the setup that you just gave us, Frusk.
Yeah, all these teleports coming down. It's numbers disadvantage. I find it hilarious, just Kled's animations when he puts his, he has his little thing over his head. Yeah. He's just charging forward. And Gimgun's confidence on the champion. But again, look at the waves. The wave is crashing forward. They have no creep waves behind them. They can get the ace here. And if this was LGD, the wave would have already been prepped, and they would have immediately taken that into a tower, possibly cracking or chipping away at inhib tower, depending on how much creep they had behind them. But because it's not, literally all they get is the gold.
And that's the difference between the two teams. You know, you have to set up in GT. If they see you slightly out of position, they'll pull the trigger, yes. But they're not constantly looking across map and what happens next. They're looking at step one. There's never a plan B or a step two to their plan. Which is fine. They still get the gold advantage. But if we look into the future now, LGD, if they continue at this pace, will still win out ahead in the long run. But it does show that GT are very strong when they get the jump on someone, and they will try and convert it into a Baron. I mean, they saw Intruder and Godby on the bottom side, and they'll just turn around onto Baron. They know this is warded. Funny's over the wall, but there's no one who can realistically steal this one away, and GT will just literally walk up and take the Baron.
LGD not respecting Game Talent's composition at all. You have the Malzahar, you have the Caitlyn, who's now broken the Infinity Edge, as well as Kha'Zix. Like, there is so much raw AD damage there. Leave it alone for 2 seconds.
I mean, that was essentially just a straight-up 20-minute Baron. That was a big oversight from LGD. And that has now firmly put GT in the lead of the game. We just say, well, all they got was the gold coming into that one. But yes, it was a little disjointed, but they got it anyway, I guess.
Well, they got their waves pushing. See, it was the long-term plan. They're like, we don't want the tower off of this ace. We're going to get the waves pushing. LGD will have to catch the waves, and during that, we'll do the 20-minute Baron. Secretly, GT are actually just the geniuses.
Yeah, I like to think that. I feel like I have to be the representative on the desk to be like, yeah, GT! But honestly, that was just a massive oversight from LGD. However, this is what happens, I feel like, in every GT game and every win that they get. It's just like, there is this misplay by the enemy team. And we see them in teams where we see, like, middle of the pack teams and top of the table teams, and then it does result in something, but GT will take this and they'll just run away with the game with it. So there's something there, there's a little bit of X factor that GT have that allowed them to take much more than typical.
The nice thing about GT is they're one of the few teams that I think recognize where they're strong. Again, we saw that in their draft phase, the priority of the Ryze pick. You know, they understand and see that Republic is a leader in the team. The fact that they're fine to give Gimgun Kled repeatedly because they know that he's confident on this champion, and that's kind of where they find these successes. They've been doing such a good job making sure that there's never a true 5v5. Like, even when we see all five members on the map, no one was there altogether. Yeah. We've never had, you know, a line of scrimmage drawn like, cross this line and I'll fight you to the death. It's always just someone chasing someone around. So if GT are constantly forcing teams onto the back foot to play their style of League of Legends, that's how they get ahead. That's how they win games. That's how they take down top teams, as opposed to the top team, you know, using that experience and veteran status to set the status quo and be proactive on the map.
Man, Republic just took that tower by himself up against Godfrey. He just couldn't approach. He was trying to clear out the wave. Maybe that wasn't the right decision in retrospect, because Republic slowly chipped down the tower. And now we're looking at a game where GT are 5 towers to 3. They have a pretty sizable gold lead, 5,000 gold ahead. They have an Infernal over Ocean, which is arguably much more important right now. LGD are just constantly on the back foot. They only have one inner tower remaining, and they're heading towards it.
And Funny needs to take a step back.
That's not really where you want to be, yeah.
I know he thinks he's real big on the shin, and he's now got POIL behind him, but GT, are they going to play this patiently, or are they going to dive it?
I think you know the answer to that question, but in the mid lane, Rengar is jumping after Republic. He'll jump away. He's good. Oh, well, that's a fast Caitlyn. Where did Gimgun go? Oh, he's way ahead of the game. He was looking to rotate towards the mid lane, but again, we said this in Champion Select, it's a very, it's an ability that is easy to see. What's the word I'm looking
Binary.
For? Binary. Telegraphed. Yes, very telegraphed ability. So LGD just walk out of the way.
But kind of think about the difference there. Like, a skirmish starts where Rengar and Corki try to make a play on Ryze, and instead of GT recognizing that they have numbers advantage to siege the tower top lane, especially with Baron buff, they're like, let's fight them. Mm-hmm. Like, let's go.
Yeah.
And they immediately leave the tower and then try to chase LGD, losing all sense of kind of momentum.
Exactly. And that's the question you asked. It's like, what are they going to do here? Yeah, of course the answer is fight if they have an opportunity. Is Gimgun's ult up? And that's the flowchart. That's it. Like, if yes, then we're going in. And that's all they need. That's all the justification they need for a fight.
It's the Kled flowchart.
Yeah.
Pressuring tower, start a fight.
Yeah, start a fight. Doesn't matter, we have advanced with Baron, whatever, man. Just let's go. We want to kill somebody.
I've never seen a champion, like, so fit the perfect essence of a team before, rather than, like,
GT or Kled.
They are Kled. Their shirt literally says fight on it.
Yeah. Ah. I'm surprised it's taking us this long to really come up with that fact, but I guess week 4 is not too bad. God V backing away. That tower's almost dead as well. GT just needs to go back up there and just one strong clutch will take it away.
Man, this would be so much easier if only they had a Baron buff.
Oh yeah, shocking. I wonder what happened to that one. Maybe we just wasted the mid lane when we were trying to run towards them. Oh.
And now they're Corki and their Varus are back in position.
Oh,
and
no,
here
Sabuki,
comes the counterplay.
Not like this. Intruder's coming after him. He's got the Gen ultimate on top of him, but he's a little too early on this one. Sabuki turns around, the ultimate comes down. Intruder will get him eventually. Xiaoyu also caught out. Gimgoon, he completes the TP, and he goes in, of course he goes in. Gimgoon is rocketing after Godfrey, but he's literally 1v5 right now. He hops off Skull, but he's not getting him back for a long time. Funny chasing after. Gimgoon's still alive. He finally gets finished off by him. They chase down Republic as well. He's turned into a snowman. The bowler goes wide. Intruder, oh, he's under attack. Republic takes him out, and this is all turned around. He finds two. West finds another one. How is this? Why is this working? It follows after. He drops the 2v5, and GT come home with the ace.
And Republic gets a quadra kill. Oh my god, I love GT. They're my favorite team now. That was hilarious. Gimgoon is so ridiculously tanky on Kled. He literally... Pulse, that was a numbers disadvantage.
Oh my god, Frost, what did I just witness?
That was 3v5, and Gimgoon's like, let's go for it. Runs in. Meanwhile, West and Republic are like, I don't know, man. Are we going into
this?
They're
like looking on, watching this, like, Kled just 1v5 the NA team. I'm just like, wait a minute. He's actually just not dying. I guess he's kind of winning. We'll jump in there. 2v5. We've got to see that one again.
Okay, this is amazing. So first and foremost, Intruder actually does a really good job. We see kind of how the soft cancer... the soft answer of Malzahar works. It definitely is playing against Rengar, let me tell you. But he survives this. So they then collapse. They take out immediately two members. And Gimgoon, this is like, that's five people. He just runs in. And the thing is Republic and West aren't doing anything right now. They haven't laid down any sort of damage. They got chunked out by Imp. And Gimgoon's health bar is pretty much done. But he's eaten up so many cooldowns that Republic is able to wait out the whimsy and then just turns on the rise.
Look at this. This is just absurd. They just don't have anything left in the tank, and Imp and Godfrey are running for their lives and it's like, oh, I still have my ultimate. I'm going in. I'm going to finish off the rest of the team.
But can you imagine how much scarier that would have been if they fought with Gimgoon? Because they literally watched Gimgoon like be the warm-up fight and then just decided to turn
it
on.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, maybe that worked out perfectly. Maybe that is the GT fight style, to be honest, because yes, they burnt all the ultimates onto Gimgoon. Had Republic and West been in there, maybe they would have been in range for some of those ultimates. So in reality, maybe that was the best way to win out the fight.
And now check out this rise. Voidstaff, Roa, Abyssal, as well as Archangels. This guy is massive and he's going in.
Here comes Kled. We're charging in. Republic's chasing after him. And Gimgoon is off to the side, but Godfrey split up from the pack. PYL locked down into the room prison. And Redemption's not going to save you on this time. Intruder backing away. Funny and him. They have to run for the hills because Gimgoon's coming. He's chasing after Funny and he has to go back to base. Three kills to GT and they're looking to close up the game.
They do have Imp still alive, but can he hold off the G8 up Skarl as well as just the power of this rise? He just needs to clear the creep wave.
Yeah, this isn't happening for us. LGD, there's not a snowball chance in hell that they're coming back into this game. Imp and Funny are doing what they can, but Gimgoon's cutting off the escape route to the spawn pad in this game. GT are on to the Nexus, and they will take game one in this best of three against LGD.
Ooh, we said it. We said how does a game occur where game talents take down LGD? A, it's LGD. You never know what kind of face or what kind of coin flip you're going to get with that team. But B, the win conditions of game talents and the fact that they understand them is what's so great to watch. They know that Republic is their carry. They know that Gimgoon is their carry. There was like 20 top lane bans that game. Gimgoon still gets the Kled, still styles on it. Priority pick for Ryze. Ryze gets a quadra kill. Like, at the top of the day, we said throw out the word consistency. Mm-hmm. Figure out what your identity is. Game talents know what it is.
I'll tell you what, Frost, that's the first time I've seen Imp without a smile on his face. That man did not look happy, and I wouldn't be either. Losing a game like that where you get 2v5s and Gimgoon is going in there 1v5 on that Kled, you got to start banning that out away from him. 1,000 gold lead turned into a massive deficit. It was all at that one point in the game when that Baron happened as well. That was another spike you can see on your screen. And in 28 minutes, GT take out LGD.
Look at that cliff. And look at that damage. Disgusting. And Again, have to say it, the Baron play. The macro shot calling certainly has tightened up from game talents. The fact that they took a very high risk, high reward 20-minute Baron. Can you imagine if you're caught on that?
Oh yeah, game's over. Yep. But you take it and you go for that play, and it's the snap decision making that catches teams off guard. And I think, like, when you look at Chinese teams, when you take them international, it's just like, man, they just went for that play. They just went for it. And teams who are, like, expecting you to, like, macro up the thing, it's like, warded, surely they won't take this Baron, and they go for it anyway. I think just GT embodies that.
The clever thing, too, is that because they have the Ryze, if they were caught on it, I forget if they used the Realm Warp to get onto the Baron faster, but there is always that factor that try the 20-minute Baron, we have the Ryze. If they come for us, we'll just bolt off of this.
Yeah.
So it was definitely a very cute, very creative composition. Again, it just goes back to this identity. Like, if GT have a mascot, it is Kled. They're only going forward.
I don't think in my wildest dreams I was expecting a game like that, because we came into this really? One. It was just like, well, we have Kled, and it will synergize with the Malzahar. He'll go in there. You also have to speed up for Ryze. Great. But I never thought we were going to see a game like that. It would happen in that way.
And it never really did happen that way. There was never that moment where, like, you know, Kled is starting out the big 5v5 and everyone's just kind of tunneled running behind him. Mm-hmm. It was just kind of these smaller skirmishes, you know, making these picks. LGD couldn't afford to be messy on the map anymore, because GT would never hesitate to try to contest them for it.
Yeah, I want to take a look at that Baron fight one more time. We have a replay here to take a look at that one. And Savoki, he starts it off. They literally just go towards it, and they take it away. It's as simple as that.
And it's just about where Intruder is on the map. You can see Rengar, he's completely on the other side. There is a ward, so LGD see it going down, but Shin's just kind of standing watching his house burn down, like, I don't know, what do you want me to do?
What can he do? He's by himself, and I don't know, man. I mean, like, LGD were just out of position, and GT pounced on it. And this is, again, like, as much as we laugh and as much as we get hyped it's fun to watch. But GT, again, this is another game where they shouldn't have gotten it, but they capitalize on a mistake from their opponents, and they go so hard that they just run over the opposing team. So my question is, coming into this next game, Frosk, is do we actually get another series where LGD turn it on and we have an EDG, an RNG, where they just run over them? We'll answer that question in a second, because Republic, I had my doubts about this guy, but I mean, the fact that he didn't die, he had a perfect KDA, and he nuked the entire team. He ran them down, and Republic fully deserves his MVP.
Yeah, still showing the power of Ryze and why they gave him the responsibility with that priority pick, you know, understanding what he can do if he's given a weapon like this. Now, the thing is LGD this time around will be on the blue side of the map, so they don't have to throw away bans at Camille, at Jace, at LeBlanc. They can choose to target out the Kled or target out the Ryze and really kind of kneecap any sort of game talents functioning victories, because it's always been with these champions.
Yeah, they should, to be honest, because that was just not okay. I mean, the fact that Republic just ran down the whole team, Gimgun went in 1v5 and survived as long as he did and set up that entire team fight for them. So yeah, I'm glad that they do now get that opportunity to start taking away some of these picks. And they do need to start taking away the Kled, but then maybe does he just go onto like a Jace, or does he go onto a different pick, and then problems start cropping up elsewhere? It's just like whack-a-mole, you know, like you eliminate one problem and another one arises for you.
Well, that's what game talents now get to prove, because mm-hmm. you have no doubt that something will be adjusted in the draft phase, that someone is going to be targeted out or forced onto a different champion. So can they still find success? Mm. In the past, and due to their standings, we would say no, that this is now where they're going to fall flat. We said that, you know, maybe LGD will probably drop game one and then pick up the next two.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
will
as
our
much
prediction
as I wanna
come
get,
true?
Yeah, I know. Like, as much as I want to get hyped, we're on the precipice once again with this team, where we look towards them and they've won game one, and we've been in this situation at least two more times. But will they just lose the rest of the series? I mean, that's really the big question. And we won't know until we get into the end of game two.
The cool thing, though, is it's always hard to make fans of kind of bottom tier teams, especially in the LPL. We have a huge lead. We've got two more teams than pretty much anyone else. So it's like, how do you, you know, drive hype or drive attention towards these bottom teams? It's so easy for game talents. Yeah. They play Kled. They will run at you. Mm-hmm. They don't give, like, see hero, kill hero. If you like bloody fast League of Legends, it is so easy to be a fan of game talents.
It's not even that. They actually pick up wins with it as well. A lot of time you see teams like this and you're just like, ah, they're scrappy. They constantly go for these fights, but then they just always lose. But they're actually picking up wins in these series. Maybe it won't take the whole series, but they'll take a game off an EDG. They'll take off a game against LGD. So regardless, I mean, it's working.
Analyst cheat words, scrappy, chaos style, skirmish heavy, are all like low key for this is a bad team.
Like, yeah, if you're out there and you like memeing, bring up the LPL bingo card because we've got more of those on the way for you in this series for sure.
But game talents are definitely kind of the little train that could. It's just the front of that train is Gimgoon. It's just like Kled, like just dragging them uphill. Mm-hmm. But once they get over that apex and they just start going, like the fact that Xiaoyu is such a new addition to the team, and he sees Intruder walk over a ward for a split second, and suddenly both Republic and Xiaoyu are pulling all of their summoners and flashing after that Rengar. Mm-hmm. You usually don't see that well-executed coordination between such a new member and such a young jungler on the team. And again, Republic is language barrier there. I mean, he speaks some Chinese, but he's their Korean import, and he's talking to a Chinese jungler, so...
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's sometimes easy to forget that as well, you know. You look at the mid lane, sometimes he's like left on an island, but it makes sense if no one can talk to him, then you just kind of leave him there. It's like, well, I'm going top lane to see if I can talk to this guy, so I'm going to make that work for us. Either way, we're going to take a quick break before we set up for game two, and we'll see if GT can finally do it. They can finally close out a series. We'll be back after the break to find out the answer to that question.